who will present us talk, Decanonization with Wasserständnisse.
Oh, hi. I'm a researcher here in the Faculty of Computer Science. I'm going to tell you about our ongoing research on this problem, decanonization. And actually, I hope that it will be easy for you because there are two parts in my talk. First is about decanonization, it is about the ethics of machine learning, and you had been invited to talk yesterday about it. And the second part is about Wasserstein distance, and it's closely related to the implicit genetic models, and you also had an invited talk yesterday about it. So you already know all the basic concepts, and I'm just going to give you the problem formulation, tell you where the adversarial network is coming, and how to improve them using this time distance. So the problem is the following. Imagine there is some company that have data about users, and they want to sell it to another company, they want to put it on Kaggle to make a competition, create a competition, and they have some target data, why they want to predict, but there is some sensitive protected features that they doesn't want to share. So they want to respect this privacy, and they already know that you cannot just remove these features, and it's okay. They can be inferred from your X features, so you need to make some feature transformation so that your Y prediction is as good as possible and your S prediction is as bad as possible. And you know here that your Y prediction must be good for some predictor, so you must be able to learn any predictor that is good, but the S prediction must be bad for any predictor, for all the predictors, so nobody can predict it well. And this problem is related to the fairlink problem of type B. And reminding you what is the parity gap. You imagine, let's say your predictor is binary, and you measure the probability of the answer yes with respect to one class, and with respect to another, and you measure the difference between them. If there are only two values of the sensitive feature, there is no maximum. If there are many values, you should take it over all the values. And so here is the parity gap for your binary predictor. And if this parity gap is low, you will say that this is fair machine learning algorithm. So if you have your data already anonymized, you can do the following. You can use this transformation to get your features and learn the predictor on these features. And this composite predictor must have low parity gap. Or otherwise, you can predict your feature S using this output of your predictor T. Well, you know how to transform conditionals, and this will give some information if there is no parity gap. Also, the problem is very close to the domain adaptation problem. You just, the domain adaptation is the following problem. You want to learn some features, or you want to learn some predictor, but you know that your domain have some domain-specific properties, and you want this predictor or features to be independent of it. So you take different data sets from different domains and say that we want to learn it as a domain-independent predictor. And if you set this S variable as a domain label, this is exactly the problem I'm talking about. And also there are already several papers on this topic of domain adaptation, which are actually very, very close to the research I will be talking about, but our research is about data anonymization. So how do we do the adversarial approach in this problem? Well, the idea is very simple. We need to measure somehow the anonymity of our data. How to measure this value? Well, we need to learn another predictor that will try to predict the value that we do not want to be predicted. And then we use this adversary predictor A to learn the feature transformation. So here we will have like three functions, typically some neural networks, so we can propagate through them easily. The first one, f from x, is our feature transformation. We have the target predictor that just predicts the y from z and the adversary predictor. And here there's already a walkup using this adversary approach to create a fair long predictor. Well, it's called centering representations, like the same as data minimization. They propose it as a data, as an anonymizer. So not only the T predictor is fair, but this F have data minimized, but I'm going to show you why it's not working very well. So a little bit more about the optimization. You have those three predictors. You have two loss functions from them. First one is just some expectation or loss function for your y prediction, the same for your adversary prediction. And to learn your feature transformation f, you need to solve this min-min-max problem over these two losses. Well, then, yes, there's some balancing weight to balance between your prediction accuracy and your data minimization. Well, as you can see, the min-min-max problem is not a very good thing to optimize. First two minimums might maybe collapse into one, but there is still a min-max which is hard to optimize. Typically it is done by the iterative gradient steps. You take one batch, you make a step for adversary, you take another batch, make a step for F and T. And it, by iterating this, you optimize your F, T and A. You may apply some schedule, like optimize adversary 5 times, optimize this 1 time, but still this is a hard problem. Well, and this approach actually have all the problems that the basic F divergence GANs have. Also, this was part of the talk yesterday. So we have very unstable adversarial game. In this game, first of all, we do not understand when we want to stop our learning. We do not know when our adversary is just random or is a little above the random. And also it is very unstable. We can have a very high change of quality between several steps. Well, this problem, actually you can learn a good representation, but it makes that you can learn a good fair predictor, but it is hard to do it. You need to make some search over parameters, search over steps and something. But the second problem is worse. Your adversarial predictor will most probably fail to represent all data properties, represent all the data modes, like in FGANs. So it will be possible to learn another predictor from scratch that will predict your protected values better. Well, and this adversary always pass on the gradients to the F function, so we have again some spikes in our graphs. So I'm going to show you the graphs for our experiments with this approach. Here we have learning steps, and on the top is the accuracy of your target y, and in the bottom the accuracy of your protected values. And I said before that you shouldn't optimize. Returning to this slide, you shouldn't optimize in this problem like to the maximum inside, then one step of minimum, again to the maximum inside. It will be very difficult to train, but here we've done actually this. We made one step of our learning and learn a new classifier on these features. So this green one, we're just taking our features at the current step and learn from random again a new classifier until it's optimal. The blue line is the classifiers that I learned inside the model, and the black line is just a baseline from features X without transformation. And so the bad thing is that however our learned classifier know nothing about the protected features, we can learn a new classifier, and it is actually as good as the classifier from the base features. Well, and we have some hard spikes here on the target accuracy. Well, if it's look at the graph of the parity gap, it is good. I mean, here the parity gap is quite low, so on some learning step we get a classifier that does not discriminate. And if you return to the previous slide, here is this point, so we also have a good touched accuracy here, but we see that a new classifier can be unfair, and we simply that putting down our features from our protective features S from this data. So knowing these problems, we applied the Wasserstein distance to this problem. I'm reminding what it is. So the intuition is the following: you have two distributions, you want to measure the distance between them. You take a set of transportation planes between these distributions, like churn distributions with marginals P and Q. You measure the distance between this using this transportation plan by taking the expectation of distance. And your distance, your final Wasserstein distance, Wasserstein point distance, is the cost for the optimal transportation plan. And this, as it was said before, yesterday, this is a very good distance measure for machine learning problems because it is weaker than F-divergence. It works better for low manifold data, and we frequently have some low manifold data in machine learning. It provides more stable gradients, as you can see in the papers concerning Wasserstein guns. So we decided to use it. And it can be calculated in some dual form. We take supremum over one Lipschitz functions. I'm not going to tell you how to constrain Lipschitz functions. It is possible, well, not relevant at all. So just you can optimize it in this adversarial kind of way. So how do we apply it to the data minimization? Well, first we assume that our target, our protective variable is binary, and now our goal is just to make this variable independent of our features, of our learned features. And this is equivalent, again, transform conditionals. This is equivalent to trying to make these probabilities equal. So we will look on the distribution of our features with respect to the one value of our protective variable, distribution of our features with respect to other value, and we compute the distance between them. If this distance is low, that means that our data is anonymized. So the full method looks like this. Again, we have our target plus. It is the same as the previous. We just use target predictor, some cross-centric or something, and it is the loss for the target. The loss for the adversary now is this Wasserstein distance. There is no real adversary here, but there is implicit function optimization inside this Wasserstein distance calculation. Well, and now we have this optimization problem. It is the same as before, as the previous, but we have different distance here, different loss function here. The mean max gain again, because we have hidden max optimization inside. Well, but it is better, it is easier to optimize it. So here are the same graphs for the Wasserstein distance. The first thing to notice, it's much more stable. And on the bottom graph, you have the quality of the new learned predictor. And you see that you can see that it goes down to the random at some learning step. And there is no blue line in the bottom because we have no explicit adversary prediction. Now we just have this distance that we are calculating. And while learning to protect our features S, we have this accuracy growing up. And the same graph for the parity gap of the learners. You can see that it's quite close to zero. And even for the new predictors, it is the same. They cannot learn such a classifier that will discriminate. So that's all about the research that was done, like there are the plans that we're going to do. We want, first of all, we want to eliminate this assumption about binary S, because it's not always the case. It is crucial here now because we compare two distributions of our features. If there are three values of S, we cannot compare three distributions. Well, we need to like sum, make a sum over all pairs or something. Well, we're thinking on it. Another future work is to apply this technique to the type C fair learning. I said that data minimization implies type B fair learning, but that's not always what is necessary. And to investigate our other distances. Well, as you heard yesterday, there are other approaches like optimal transport and so on that maybe they can give even more stable and better results. That's all, thank you.
Any questions?
How do you maximize to get the Bessig-Stein distance towards?
You mean how do we calculate this thing?
Yes, because like you said that we instead of min-min-max problem get just two min problem, but the fact that you just hidden the max problem inside this Wasserstein distance, and I didn't understand why you're solving the, it's in two steps, it's easier than just solving in one.
It doesn't solve that we have a min-max problem, it is still in min-min-max, we're still and this iterative, this step over f and t and next step over d, but this Wasserstein distance provides like the most stable gradients in this game.
So we still need to choose a strategy to...
Yeah, we still need to iterate over optimizations, but the parameters of this optimization doesn't matter so much like in the previous game.
And you just choose whatever the best you start like.
Well, no, we optimize at each step our discriminator here too. So we take step for discriminator, take step for the features, take step for discriminator.
Step by step.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, also, actually, the authors claim that, authors of this improved Wasserstein Gansel claim that you can learn this Wasserstein discriminator from the beginning and set it constant and use only and optimize only min-min game. I haven't tried it yet, I'm going to, but I don't know, it will work here.
Okay. I have a question about this equation, the bottom of the slide.
Yep.
Here you're saying that this is a min-min-max problem, but see, your LA is roughly a max, but then it enters the last equation with the minus, with the minus sign. So it actually becomes min-min-min. Where is something wrong? Because LA is W, which is maximization, but then it enters the equation with a minus sign.
So you suggest to switch the sign here and switch min max to min? And
yeah, because it, minus max is min of minus something.
Wait, can I do that? Because it depends on F. If we switch sign here, we will need to switch here.
It's the same, I think, very inside. So what you have written there is minus alpha. And that's the maximization over something. You can write plus alpha minimization of minus something instead.
And then it's min-min-min.
And then it's min-min-min.
So, sorry, I don't understand how you switch sign here and you don't have to switch sign here.
Okay.
So let us thank the speaker again.
Hello. I will tell you about
learning to learn or meta learning in the context of optimization. First, I will tell you about what is learning to learn. Then I will present four problem formulation, and then I will describe several approaches to this problem and present some of my results. So, what is learning to learn? In the recent papers, there are mainly two kinds of meta-learning. One of them is few-shot meta-learning, and the other one is meta-optimization. And what is few-shot meta-learning? You have some set of tasks or distribution of tasks and some fixed model, and you need to somehow transform this model in some way that it should be easily adaptable to any new task. And it is really nice because you need to learn one model and then you can train it with small amount of data on any new task, which is quite similar to tasks in the set. But that approach is not quite flexible because the model is fixed, and when you want to switch to some other tasks, you need to train your model. And here comes the meta-optimization. What is meta-optimization? You have some number of problems, and you want to train the model which can act as an optimization algorithm. This approach is more flexible because you have one separate model for optimization, and it can train other models on whatever task you want. And that's what my talk will be about. Mr. K. So let's discuss problem formulation. In deep learning, almost everyone uses some first order optimization methods like stochastic gradient descent and so on. And pretty much all of these algorithms can be described using these two equations. So that algorithm is described by function g, which takes in gradients of the function as inputs. Also, it has some parameters phi, and it has some sort of memory denoted by h. And so, on the each iteration, algorithm updates its memory, outputs step, and then it updates the parameters. And there is a question, how do we train the optimization algorithm? We see that it has parameter phi, and we can learn them, but how do we do it? We need to devise some kind of loss function over phi and minimize it with some another optimization method, for example, stochastic gradient descent. Here are a couple of loss functions which are used in the papers. Sometimes you want to account for the whole trajectory, sometimes not. T here denotes the number of iterations for which you run your optimization algorithm. To be even more explicit, to train optimizer, you need to run several iterations of your optimization, and then you can run backpropagation through computational graph and update the parameters of optimizer. Yes. So what do we want? Actually, if we look at the equations, we can see here that this is pretty general equations. And for example, function g can be represented by some recurrent neural network because it has memory, it has some variable length inputs. So why don't we use RNN? So we just try to plug RNN in here, but is everything good with that formulation? Because
it's
there is some problem with that formulation. And the problem is that number of parameters of recurrent neural network actually depends on the dimensionality of inputs, which in turn depend on dimensionality of the optimization problem. And we do not want to depend on dimensionality of optimization problem because, for example, we want to train on some simpler problems that can have different dimensions, and then we would like to run our optimization algorithm on different, for example, neural networks which have different dimensionalities. And another problem is that if number of parameters grows linearly with dimensionality of optimization problem, then we cannot run this optimization algorithm on neural networks because they have billions of parameters and our algorithm would have even more parameters. The solution to this problem is actually quite simple. We need to just to share optimization algorithm parameters across the coordinates. And so, in fact, our optimization algorithm becomes coordinate-wise, so that coordinates are independent and can process them sequentially or like all of them, and it can treat them like a batch of some independent problems. So how does it work? We get our parameter vector theta on each iteration. We compute function value, we compute gradients. Then we pass these gradients to the optimization algorithm. It processes them, outputs step, and then we update our parameter vector theta with this step. So now I will describe several approaches to meta learning. One of them is called DM optimizer. DM refers to DeepMind. It was one of their first papers on meta optimization. Actually, it was quite simple model that did just what I described. It took gradients as inputs, output its step, and the LSTM was quite small because actually each input was one-dimensional, so we didn't need to use some really big LSTMs. But there were some drawbacks of this model. The first, the main of them is the low generalization. Where does this come from? They train this model on some almost fixed optimization problem, where they trained some multi-layer perceptron for classification on NIST, and the only source of randomness was from random order of batches and random initialization. And so model overfitted badly, and for example, if we change iteration from sigmoid to rule, model diverged. If we increased number of layers or number of units, it didn't diverge, but the performance was much worse. The next model is RNN prop. It's a successor to DM optimizer. Their architecture was quite the same, but training was different. First of all, they introduced random scaling, and that they tried to make algorithm independent from scale of the problem. the next trick was to add some convex, simple convex function, for example, simple quadratic, and that helped a lot during the earlier phase of optimization, of learning to optimize, of learning of the optimizer, because like the optimizer is coordinate-wise, so it gets stable learning signal from the second function, and it quickly learns baseline such as gradient descent, for example. Also, they replace the inputs to the LSTM. They, in the first paper, gradients were used, and in that paper, they replaced it with steps which they get from RMS prop and ADEM to like good algorithms, and they have property that their step is independent of the scale of the problem also, so they made their model automatically independent of scale. Okay, so let's look at the results of the earlier problem. It has relatively good generalization, especially when we see DM optimizer. But it is much better than it, but actually it's not much better than ADEM, it's almost the same. And okay, we didn't tune, for example, learning rate, and we got almost the same performance as ADEM with tuned learning rate, but we hoped for something better. So I started on my research looking at earning drop and tried to improve that. For that, I used model. How does it work? I called it normal STM. Firstly, I looked at the ADEM and I decided that these quantities that are counted inside the ADEM, I want to use them because they are something useful, and maybe OSTM can learn something from it. But then the paper called something like normalized gradients in deep learning inspired me to use also normalized version of ADEM, where in these equations you need to replace gradient with normalized gradient. And it is actually one of the important steps, because normalized gradients, they boost performance on some simple, on some non-stochastic problems very much. There are also some details, I don't want to explain them, they are not so important, but instead let's look at the results. So the upper plot is the performance, mean performance on Rosenberg function, sampled randomly. The blue line is normal STM. The cyan line is random drop, and we can see that at non-stochastic problems, normal STM is much better than random drop, and the reason for that is possibly because random drop wasn't trained on non-stochastic problems, but we can see that even though normal STM was trained only on stochastic problems, it performs on non-stochastic problems also. It has good performance. And the lower plot is called my function, and here we can see that normal STM is doing better than ADEM. And so in non-stochastic problems, normal STM is at least not worse, and it is comparable or better. However, let's look at the stochastic problems. you can see that performance is quite comparable to both Aaron and Prof and Aiden. These are experiments on some small convolutional network on CITAR-10 and MIST. And there are also there is also one interesting effect that we can see. Here is the plot on multi-layer perceptron on MIST. You can see that all methods are kind of the same, and if we increase the number of layers from 2 to 5, the normal STM and random drop are they become better.
Sorry, can you please enumerate which color means because we cannot see?
Dark blue is normal STM. Blue is random drop. And if we increase number of layers even more, then we can see that Adam struggles to perform in a good way, and the two learned algorithms, they learned somehow, and normal STM is a bit better than others. So so we can see that if we increase complexity, it is harder to tune Adam to the same performance, but nevertheless, learned optimizers they work almost at the same level. And so, to conclude my report, we can see that first of all, learned optimizers have no tunable parameters, and that's an advantage because you can just plug it in somewhere and you don't need to tune anything. Also, you've got very good performance in non-stochastic problems, but on stochastic problems there is need for future work because in the moment on some problems learned optimizers are worse than ADOM, although they don't require any tuning. And also, training of these optimizers is a bit unstable, but it can be mitigated. That's the beauty. So, that's all. Thank you.
Questions?
Yes.
Can you try to use the learn not to replace Aiden, but to improve Aiden? Say, like, try to choose like first step learning rate for Aiden? Because normally, like in your experiments, you don't decrease the learning rate for Aiden during the optimization process, and normally this helps a lot.
Yes.
If you could learn a model that could do that for you, that would save a lot of tuning.
Yes, actually, I've tried this. It is quite promising, but in fact, in experiments, I see that if we learn not the step, but an addition to Atom step, then it helps than just Atom step.
But what about rescaling Atom steps?
I'm sorry?
Like, what about rescaling Atom step? Because
Yes. We just learn learning rate for Atom, and it is like different for every iteration.
Can you repeat, please, how you use, like, how you train LSTM and which optimizing? I think what is input and what is out.
Here we have our loss function. It's an expectation, but. So how do we optimize expectation? We just sample from it, like we sample some function f, then we run optimization, and we can propagate gradients to parameters of optimizer. Do you see? Does it seem Okay. So we can just propagate gradients to parameters of LSTM because everything is differentiable.
And you update LSTM weights with SGD?
No, actually I used ADEM. But
yes. So you use ADEM to update weights on LSTM, and then you use this RNN to
optimize some other problem. Yes.
And what are the problems that you optimize? Like, where in the graph where you show us performance, what is the task that? What is that?
Here it is the upper plot. The upper plot is on classification on NIST using some convolutional network which has like convolution pooling that several times you connected, and the lower plot is on Spartan.
On
the same architecture.
Sorry, I didn't get that one. What the lower one?
The same architecture on Spartan.
Ah, okay.
Mm-hmm. And it works faster than ADEM, yes?
In terms of time per iteration, it is a bit longer because it already computes what ADEM computes, but when you use quite large batches, the difference in performance is quite negligible.
And do you think that RNN can memorize ADEM? I don't know how to English habits and reuse them. As I see, they work in the same way. Yes, I see this. But
yes. I mean, to be honest, I checked if. Like what direction do LSTM output, and these directions are quite not the same because I looked at cosine of angle between the two vectors, and they look in very different directions.
Okay. Yeah.
Thanks, Bernard.
Some set of features features are missed. So our goal is to reconstruct the distribution of missed features conditioned on the observed features of the given sample. The point is that we want to do that for all possible missed feature sets. So let us look on the special case. If we consider missing feature set equal to the whole features, then we know nothing about what our data is
on the testing stage. So we have to reconstruct the joint distribution over X, and this is generic model. And if we fix the set of missed features, just fix it, then we obtain conditional discriminative model, which models the distribution of missed features. And the last but not the least is that the distribution of missed features is complex. It means that we can have multiple models, and we want to model the distribution, but not the most probable value or the mean values of it. So it is the complex problem. Is it okay with the problem statement?
No, I just didn't get. You have a number of features, and you remove some of them, and you want them to restore.
We have a distribution over our vector X.
Yes.
And sometimes the features are lost, and we want to restore.
So you have additionally a distribution over all of the features.
No. We have implicitly. We have a data set of samples from X, and on the training stage, for example, and on the testing stage, we have the same story, but some features are missed.
Okay.
And we want to reconstruct them. Let us consider the problem. So we want to reconstruct distribution, and we know that variational autoencoders are good with this problem. We know also that the generative adversarial nets can be used, but they work worse with multimodal distributions, so we choose variational autoencoders. I hope. I will organize my talk as follows. First, I will briefly remind you something about variational autoencoders. I hope you know it already from the yesterday's invite talk. Then I will talk about conditional variational autoencoders, which is the extension of the ordinary variational autoencoders. Then I will talk about conditional variational autoencoders for missing feature reputation, which is actually the further extension of that model, and which is the topic of my research. So, variational autoencoder is the whole generative model. The generative process is follows. Firstly, we generate standard normal latent vector Z, and then we use generative distribution conditioned on this vector Z. To generate the sample of X, and we learn generative distribution in order to maximize log likelihood of our observable data set, and also we make our model distribution over X similar to the true distribution over X. We do learning of the generated distribution by maximization of variation lower bound on log likelihood of the model. The variation of lower bound is on the slide, and its derivation is straightforward. You can do it in two lines using the Jensen's inequality. So the variational lower bound is maximized with respect to parameters of generative distribution, And he introduced the proposed distribution, which is conditioned on the sample of vector x, and this distribution is over vector z from left-hand space. So we optimize our lower bound with respect to parameters of both distributions, and these distributions are Gaussian, parameterized by neural networks, because on one hand it is a rather flexible model, and on the other hand it is easy to train. One more thing I want to say is that there is two parts in variation lower bound. The first part is the reconstruction loss, and the second part is the regularizer, which makes our proposed distribution is similar to the prior distribution in the latent space. So how it works? In my office, there was another image, we have a proposal network, we have a prior distribution, which is standard normal, and our proposal network generates distribution from which we generate Z, and we optimize both proposal network and generation network in order to reconstruct what proposal network have on input. This model, learning this model, provides us with some meaningful features. On the slide, you can see the embedding of a two-dimensional latent space of variation of encoder learned on NIST. And now we continue with conditional variation of encoders. So, conditional variation of the encoder, here we have another problem. We have two vectors x and y, and we have joint distribution on them, and our goal is to learn the distribution over y conditioned on x. But the probabilistic model is nearly the same as in the variational after encoder. The generative process is follows. First, we have vector x, and we generate latent vector z conditioned on x. And after that, we generate our vector y conditioned on x and z vectors. So the derivation of variation lower bound for this model differs from variation of encoder in two points. Firstly, we model the distribution over y, not x. And secondly, we just condition all the distributions in our model on x. And that works. The only significant difference is that now our prior distribution over Z is also conditioned on vector x. So this distribution is also modeled, also parameterized with neural network, and it is also Gaussian. What happens here? What must happen here? Consider the following problem. We have upper part of NIST digit as our vector x, and we have our lower part of NIST digit as vector y. The proposal network sees both upper and lower part of digit, both x and y. It also generates a point in latent space from which a generator can restore the lower part. But also we train prior distribution here. we train it by minimizing divergence between proposal distribution and prior distribution. So the prior distribution the prior distribution contains a lot of contains the region of Latin space which corresponds to given vector X, and the proposal network specifies the area in that region from which current sample can be generated, and another good point about learning prime distribution is that it is not fixed to be standard normal distribution with a fixed number of dimensions. So during learning procedure, we can avoid some dimensionality. But on the testing stage, we have no proposal network. We have only our prior network, which generates some latent vectors Z, and from it we generate our vector Y. That is surely the issue of the model, because there are space in a prior distribution where no point from proposal distribution lies, and the samples generated from these spaces are not so good. But okay, here is the architecture of neural network used to solve the problem. So what we can see. The upper part of the digit is fixed, and the lower part is generated using conditional variation autoencoder. We can see that the lower parts are sharp, they are realistic, and they are rather diverged. So it works somehow. We can say that we want to optimize that prior distribution explicitly. So the problem is that in learning process there are no points generated from prior distribution. That is bad. We can avoid it by saying that proposal distribution prior distributions are equal. That means the proposal distribution is does not depend on y vector, and it leads to much worse quality, and it leads to very smooth samples, and these samples are not diverged, and actually our architecture turns into a stochastic feedforward Gaussian network, which explains bad results. But suddenly, mixing this model works better than conditional variation autoencoder model. Actually, we can explain it that during learning conditional variation autoencoder, there are some points in prior distributions that are not considered, and now we learn our prior distribution both using chain divergence with proposal distribution and explicitly. So that works. And that is what I can say about conditional variation autoencoders model. Let's go on with our problem setting. We have to learn on conditional distribution. To do it, we just maximize the average likelihood of all our conditional models. But to that we introduce missing features binary mask, one means that feature is, that reported feature is missed, and zero means that we can see that feature, and the circle on the slide means element wise product. So we perform the following maximization. Again, we can derive variation lower bound easy enough. It is very similar to the lower bound for conditional variation after encoder. The only difference is that we have to use Jensen's inequality two times instead of one to put logarithm inside the expectations. So again, our proposal network C is the whole vector. Generative network in our architecture C only a latent vector, and prime network C what we see. So we made a number of experiments. First experiment is proof of the concept. We generate a mixture of Dirichlet distributions, and we can marginalize them analytically, and we can marginalize them by using our learned model. And we can see that the analytical marginal density function over condition, the density function over one of the components has the same shape as the density function learned by our model. The second experiment is on MNIST dataset. Here our masks are not completely random. Here our mask is a random horizontal line on the image. So what we see is the left big image, what the model see. Ground truth is right big image, and here is what we generate. We can see once again that for arbitrary mask from our distribution over masks, horizontal lines, the samples are once again sharp, diverge, realistic. Also this extends to color images. We tried Street View House number dataset, in which images are 32 times 32 and have a three color channel. Here we have to use convolutional and deconvolutional neural network architectures. And what we see, once again, the left column is what model sees, the right column is ground truth, and all other columns is what model generates. We can see that, for example, instead of zero on the first row, model generates, we can generate 2 and 3 and 8, for example. Well, the problem is this dataset that the digits in it very smooth, like in the last column on human wars. So the results are not so impressive, maybe. And the last experiment, we used our model to restore real missed features in some data set. So we take a data set from UCI, artificially drop some features for each object from it, and used the three missing feature imputation technique. First is just inputting averages. Second is to learn feed-forward neural network, which inputs something, and use our model. And what is very good about it is that we can see that the samples for our model lead to much better quality. No, well, not much better, but but quality in some regression problem, then has a methods of feature imputation. So it can help in some common transfer problems. To conclude my speech, we propose the model which can be generative, can be considered as generative and as discriminative, and it works, and that is all I have to say about it.
We have time only for one short question, if we have one. Okay, no? So, next.
Four first speakers were about NLP, and I am the last speaker about NLP because the conditional generators of words, maybe it's about NLP. Okay, we will generate text. Okay, what is the... it is the outline of my talk. Almost every speaker told us about RNNs and word embeddings, and I will be fast on the second and the third part of my talk. So, what is the motivation of our research? There are different word embeddings, such as Word2Vec, Loaf, Fastex, and etc. As Anna Potapenko said, that most effective way to measure the quality of word embeddings is to use analogical tasks and word similarity tasks. But these tasks need to use some similarity metrics, and it is not so directed way to measure the quality. We wanted to create a more direct way for evaluation of different word embeddings. Okay, and to do this, we wanted to introduce the definition modeling task as a measure of quality of word embedding. I'll describe it later. Okay, our work needs some basic blocks such as RNNs. All the people know this thing is the block that sequentially applies some function on input vectors and memorize some information which was accumulated across time steps. Okay, RNNs can be used for language modeling tasks. What is language modeling? Also, we all know this. We want to model the probability of this sequence of tokens. It might be they might be words or symbols and etc. We use chain rule to rewrite this probability as follows, and it is easy to see that each separate probability can be modeled by output of the recurrent neural network. Okay, and what we need more, it is the word embedding, because one hot encoding is can be used for can can be viewed as a distributed representation of world because there are no semantic relatedness and etc. As Anna said, that original escape ramp word to date model is optimizes the likelihood of context words Y given the corresponding words S, and it is can be considered as the state of the art model in this sphere. But one problem in this model that this model can't model representations for words that have different meanings. For example, bank or spring. And to extend this model, authors of another word embeddings model called adaptive skip gram model, they extend this probability of for the given word W to this one. Now each word has at least k meanings. K meanings, yes. And for automatically determine the number of meanings, we use authors of this model use the Dirichlet prior, as Professor Bantine yesterday showed us that this prior can be used for describing the prior probability on discrete variables to obtain the number of meanings of something. Yes, and then the joint model is written as follows, and is optimized by stochastic variational inference, which Oleg described us to. Okay, and the model is optimized in fully factorized variational approximation. Okay, but when we train this model, we need one more operation called disambiguation. What is it? It's a probability of the meaning of word given the word and its context. For example, if we want to compute what meaning has word apple if the context is a new iPhone was announced yesterday. Yes. So the meaning neighbors will be Macintosh, computers, iPad, and etc. So we need this operation for computing the embedding of the word. Okay, so these models, RNNs and word embeddings will be used as the blocks in our work. And what is the definition modeling? Okay, let's I assume that W with star is a word being defined, and the D is its definition. Then the probability of D given the W star is the definition model. So it's quite similar with the language model, but this model is conditioned on W star. So how can we consider this dependence on W star in the RNN? First of all, the most simple way is to consider the dependence on the recurrent block. For example, LSTM can get the X star, which is an embedding of the W star, as the input also. Not only hidden state from the last from the previous step, and XT is the input on the T step, and also X star, the embedding of the word being defined. Okay, and the second way is to add W star to the definition set. So hidden states on the on the time zero will have an information about word being defined. Okay, these two ways we will use in our models. So I need to say that we pre-trained our language model with the on the Wikipedia to obtain language semantics and then fine-tune the definition model on the definition dataset. Okay, and the first embeddings that we use for XStar is a word-to-vec embeddings. And we got such impressive results for the test words. These words were obtained by the model using Beam Search. Yes, using Beam Search. We took the most probable sample from the Beam Search. As we can see, all the words are quite good defined. And yes, the and let's look on errors. As errors, we can look at the word bank. Its true definition from the data set is this sloping line, especially the slope beside the body of water. But our model defined it as the act of financing something. And it's not an error, it's like another meaning of a word. And or crystal is a solid form by the solid phase, and etc. Our model says that it is the quality of being bright, this different parts of species. The true is a noun and the generated is an adjective. So it's not an error, really. No. Faith is a reformulation. These words were in the train. In the train set. So this word models sees on the train stage. But model didn't memorize it and just find another meaning. What we wanted to do next, we wanted to take into consideration the words with multiple senses. To do this, we used Enneagram, and we got these definitions. The zero meanings were in the training stage, and the other meanings model didn't see. And it's also quite impressive results because we see that simple language model can restore the meanings of words using its definition or using its embedding. These are selected examples for the adaptive skip ground conditioning. And also we did some experiments, some numeric experiments. We used blur score and blur on polysemantic. It is the polysemantic words. It the words with more than one meaning from the point of view of adaptive skip ground. If the prior probability of meanings, or if the probability of word of the meanings of word has more than one meaning, then it is the polysemantic word. And as we see, adaptive skip ground conditioning won versus word-to-vec conditioning and RNN language model, unconditioned model when we condition on zeros. So as an X star, as an embedding of the word being defined, we use the vector of zeros. Okay, and to conclude, and what is the work in progress now? We want to do more numerical experiments because if we model this probability, now we can use this for ranking tasks. For example, let's fix the definition of word, and then we can iterate over all W stars on the train set and choose the best one from the point of view of this probability. And the inverse task, when we fix W star and choose the definition, the correct definition of this model. Okay. And Also, we wanted to apply attention mechanisms for embeddings, and we wanted to make dataset much better, because now definitions, generated definitions, are very small in length, and the problem is in the dataset also. Okay, thank you for your attention. I'm ready to answer the question.
Any questions?
What is the size of the training dataset?
Oh, it's quite small. Which dataset? For pre-training? On the Wikipedia or the definition dataset?
The definition
dataset is very small. It's 4,000 words and its definitions. Because there are not so many words in English that people use every day. And if we will use rubbish words, we can use the Oxford dictionary, the full Oxford dictionary.
But why don't you use it?
Because the most of the words are rubbish. There are many examples of words that we don't use in our for the speech, and this model. These words can worsen the results of our model because of the rubbish. it's hard to explain because you didn't see the words.
You don't want to make your model worse.
Yes, I don't know.
So now you have 1,000 words.
40,000.
40,000.
Yeah. How do you get it? How did you get it? You just how did you choose that the
first
word is rubbish?
The first version of the dataset, I used the WordLink API for getting these words. But now I use Oxford API, Oxford dictionaries, and Oxford API provides the frequencies of usage of this word. So I can rank these words and then choose the most. Yes.
So did you say 40,000?
40,000.
40?
Yes.
So you've got 40,000 definitions?
Yes. And yes.
I wouldn't worry too much. I mean, anything below 40,000 is virtually unused. So most people have only have 5,000 in there.
But for the deep learning models, it's quite simple model. But I think that the improvement of the size of the dataset can improve the results.
Yeah.
So it's
it seems that you have all the rubbish words in your dataset, and you can have more.
Yes.
Sometimes people say that this is a regularization. This isn't right.
No, it's not.
Okay, thanks again.
Image in the set that's not a human one. It can be described as follows. On the first stage, we transform all images into feature vectors, then we take a query image, transform into a feature vector 2, and compute all distances, and take the most closest and regard it as similar. Of course, the exhaustive search is not used for big data sets, but I can talk about it on this next slide. So that's how modern I don't know why it's so sharp. No, it's not sharp, it's so sharp. It's a kind of model trivial system. So here we use so deep called deep neural codes or deep neural descriptors as a feature vectors. It's just activations from the top or from the top layers of the micro convolutional neural networks that are involved by FHM. Then they compress because they are very high dimensionally, and then we often use the indexing algorithms. The state-of-the-art example of if it is inverted with its algorithm, it means we take all vectors. In natural local space, we comprise all vectors, store only its centers, and indices of corresponding images. When the query image comes, we take images that correspond to the closed clusters and its neighbors. The amount of clusters defines the precision of the retrieval. So often we use so-called product continuation when we divide our vectors at halves and clusterize obtained data sets independently and then use direct product. So we can obtain the square amount of the clusters. Such approach has several problems. First, when we do PCA compression, it's just a linear one, so it may be insufficient. We can do it better. And the second problem is regards to deep neural descriptors. The problem with it is that it is very redundant because, for example, when we before we used SIF descriptors, the each coordinates describes some part of the image, and when we use deep neural descriptors, the part of the vector, they correspond to each other, and it causes a problem on the indices stage because when we understand, when we clusterize the part of the vectors, then from the fact that the first part of the vectors comes into some clusters yields information about another. So in the whole gallery we had a lot of empty clusters, and it reduced speed of the retrieval and the performance. So the next problem is that in such a manner we are able to only to obtain binary, obtain only continuous image representation, and sometimes we want to obtain binary descriptors, which may be useful, for example, for storing or for faster retrieval. And it is good to have some combined method when we have an additional text representation of the image, and we want to use not only joining descriptors from the image, but from, for example, text, if you have some image that are annotated with text in some applications. So, what we propose is to use visual encoders for encode the deep neural descriptors. I won't tell you once again what is visual encoder, but I will tell you, maybe not everybody knows, what to do if we want to obtain a discrete latent variable. So, this paper was published this year, so it is very easy. It is called categorical version of the encoder. The key idea of it is that we use so-called Gumpelmann trick to sample from the discrete distribution. Argmax is not differential, but because of this, it is approximated with Gumpel's sigmoid function, or with a parameter tau, and it have a property that this Gumpel distribution, complete distribution, it has parameters. It has a property that as tau reaches zero, the samples from it becomes one fold. So we can learn our compressed representation by tuning this parameter, and there is trade-off between discreteness and variance of the gradient. So we make the parameter big and then annealing it to the zero to obtain a discrete variables. So we use a technique and try to solve the problems that are appearing in the current model. So first problem was redundancy. We make a series of tricks that we can interpret searching for compression distribution as a problem of maximizing probability of the observed variables over all possible latent variables with the additional constraints that make pressure on our distribution to make it as close to sense that we want for, and we want it to be as a tropic Gaussian as far as it has a less abundance. So if we write it as a Lagrangian, it is just a famous, well-known Elba slow bound with the additional coefficient with the k divergence, which is act as a regularizer. And so by tuning it during training procedure, we can increase the pressure of the Kalilius restraint and make our distribution more isotropic and but still unable to reconstruct. So we make experiments. I hope you see that's the number. So what we do? We take 20,000 to 20. Not 20. 200 of thousand images that are kind of provided with, to us with Yandex data set, we made it from the internet. And what we do, we split this data set, or we use networks to obtain feature vectors, then we split all obtained feature data sets at halves, clusterize them independently, and then measure mutual formation between the clusters. So if the mutual formation is low, then it means that our redundancy is less, and if it's big, that our it means that our redundancy is bigger. So we compare these results to the current state of the methods, and we can tell that if we use this variational three-quarter technique for compression instead of PCA, we don't need to use some complicated methods of orthogonalization. We use just original Engel bearing. So the next our attempt was to make to binarize the feature vectors. So we use double sigmoid, we use triple octave encoder, but we have a problem that that the quality of the retrieval does not depend on the length of the code proportion. It doesn't is not proportional. So there is some code length after each the precision will decrease. It means that we start to investigate, it occurs that after some amount of bits, some Latin variables didn't learn anything, they just sampled from Bernoulli distribution. So we just make some heuristic to distinguish meaningful and non-meaningful distribution based on standard deviation of the variance. Also probabilities, and then we compare. We use this discretization to compare this method, our method with the current methods. We don't compare with the highest one because it's supervised, and our method is unsupervised. It is important because we don't have level data, for example, on that set of next providers. And we can say that we perform on the same level as the current. It has some drop during the lens. It's not very dramatic. So and I was in, our last sprint was what we do is we just we want to understand can we benefit somehow from using additional type description if we use version of the encoder. So we come transform to vector space. We have in the other set we have additional type description, and then we want to know can is it some synergy between if we use simultaneously after encoder with the text description and with the deep neural descriptor, and it is we measure evidence law amount, and we can say that this green one is the sum of the evidence law amount of the variational after encoder that are learned independently, and the blue one is the evidence law amount if we train simultaneous attacks and descriptors. So this is the picture show the performance of the retrieval procedure with the various type of coding descriptors.